Right, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this, the second meeting in 2016 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome all members, welcome the Cabinet Secretary and witnesses who I'll introduce in a second. And I can remind everyone, please to turn off or at least turn to silent all mobile phones and other electronic devices. Item one on the agenda, our members are happy that we take item three, which is consideration of our draft report on the Budget Scrutiny 2016-17 in private. This is item three on the agenda, and are we also content that we take consideration of the draft report in private at future meetings?
Agreed.
That's agreed. Thank you very much. Item two, our concluding session, evidence session in relation to Draft Budget Scrutiny 2016-17. I'd like to welcome to give evidence on the Scottish Government's draft budget, John Swinney, Deputy First Minister, Cabinet Secretary of Finance, Constitution and Economy, who's joined today by John Mason, Director of Economic Development, and Mary McAllan, Director of Energy and Climate Change at the Scottish Government. So welcome to you all. Before we get into questions, Mr. Swinney, do you want to say something by way of an opening statement?
I would, Kavir, thank you for the opportunity to discuss the 2016-17 budget with the committee today. In presenting the budget, the government is determined to build on the consistent approach that we've taken since 2007 to create opportunities for all of our citizens to flourish through increasing sustainable economic growth. That challenge has to be exercised within the constraints of the public finances that are available to us, and as I have set out to Parliament, by the end of this decade, the Scottish Government's discretionary budget will be 12.5% lower in real terms than it was in 2010-11. We have focused in the budget choices we've made in this area of the Government's activity on supporting the implementation of the Government's economic strategy, principally around the themes of investing in our people and infrastructure, in fostering a culture of innovation, in continuing to promote Scotland internationally to boost trade and trade networks, and to promote inclusive growth. To summarise some of those principal themes, we've chosen to invest £116 million in Scotland's digital infrastructure next year, a transformational investment to help meet our 2017 target that 95% of premises in Scotland will have access to next-generation broadband. And we've continued to support the small business bonus scheme, and in line with our recognition of energy efficiency as a national infrastructure priority, we will complement our efforts and existing schemes with the development of Scotland's energy efficiency programme. We will also continue to facilitate business and community investment in the low-carbon infrastructure through the Renewable Energy Investment Fund and specific low-carbon and community investment support schemes. On innovation, we see this as the key to tackling the productivity challenge within the Scottish economy, and we're committing more than £345 million to support innovation through our enterprise agencies and the Scottish Funding Council. Many of the opportunities to boost the competitive strength of the Scottish economy will come in our international activity, where we've seen good performance in the increase in international exports. And to support that, we're establishing three new innovation and investment hubs in London, Brussels and in Dublin, and we'll continue to support Scottish Development International to help companies expand internationally. And finally, Convener, on the theme of inclusive growth, the Government has taken forward steps to encourage and to motivate support for the Scottish Business Pledge, a voluntary commitment by companies to adopt fair and progressive business practices through the adoption of the Living Wage and other commitments, and the establishment of the Fair Work Convention will assist in developing a fair employment and workplace framework by March 2016. We take forward these measures within the priorities that are set in the Government's economic strategy and our programme for government, and I look forward to discussing those with the committee this morning.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister, for that introduction. We're conscious you need to be away by 11, I think, to go to the Finance Committee. So I'd remind members if they would to keep their questions as short and to the point as possible, and answers as short and to the point as possible would be helpful to get us through the topics in the time available. I think that the areas we're keen to cover this morning are non-domestic rates, tourism, fuel poverty, the Fair Work Agenda, the enterprise agencies, and finally, renewable energy. And I hope we can get through that in the time that's available to us. Could I maybe start off asking about non-domestic rates? There is, within the budget documentation, if I read it correctly, an expectation that the income from non-domestic rates projected for the coming year is to fall by £30 million. And there is reference to the fact that there has been lower than forecast growth in the tax base, leading to this fall. Can you maybe just explain a little bit more detail why you think that's come about?
There's a number of factors that have contributed to this situation. First of all, on inflation, the 2015-16 poundage increase was capped at 2%, which our previous estimate when we'd made the long-run forecast of NDRI was of an inflation figure of 2.3% in September 2014, which would have given rise to a 2.3% increase in the poundage. And that contributes to a drop in income in the current and the forthcoming year, which always affects the size of the non-domestic rates pool. In addition to that, expectation had been in September 2015 of an inflation forecast of 3.3%, which translated in fact into 2.1%, and that was reduced further in the March budget statement to 0.9%. So there is a cumulative effect of that lower inflation factor. Secondly, the buoyancy estimates that we had an estimate of a buoyancy level for 2014-15 of 1.55%, and that actually translated into an actual of 0.82%. So the growth in buoyancy was not as large as we had predicted. So those factors have affected the strength of the non-domestic rates pool, and as a consequence I've taken steps to try to maintain as far as possible the income that arises from non-domestic rates.
Okay, thank you for that. Just to follow up then on that last point, so your proposal is to double the large business supplement that goes from 1.3 to 2.6%. How much are you expecting to raise from that measure?
From that measure we would expect to raise about 60 million pounds.
£60 million. Okay. And although it's called the large business supplement, do you accept that there are many medium-sized businesses that would be affected, given it attaches to properties with a rateable value of £35,000 or more, which would mean there are many, you know, reasonably modest-sized shops in our high streets, for example, that would be hit by that supplement?
I think you're correct that the supplement applies to properties with a rateable value of £35,000, convener. And clearly those businesses are familiar with paying the large business supplement as part of the existing arrangements that they have. When you look at the detail of the annual increase that will come as a consequence of this, for a company that is paying the large business supplement, their business rates will rise by 3.4% between 2015-16 and 2016-17. If we look back to 2011-12, the increase for similar companies was 4.6%, and in 2012-13, 5.8%. So the scale of the increase, although you're correct in all the detail that you've said there, convener, in the context of business rate rises and changes over the course of the last 6 years, the change from 2.3%, and that's the annual increase, which includes the core element of the business poundage and the large business supplement, would be going from 2.3% to 3.4%, which is smaller than it was in two of the recent years in this respect.
Okay, thanks for that. Both yourself and the First Minister have been quite strong in the past talking about the need to create a competitive business rates regime in Scotland. However, this particular budget proposes doubling the larger business supplement and making it substantially higher than the rate payable south of the border. How does this fit with what the First Minister said about making Scotland the most attractive place in the UK to do business? Do you not think it sends out the wrong signal?
No, because there are a variety of other areas of the approach that we take towards business rates where we have a significantly more advantageous position in the provisions that we have in place compared to the position south of the border. So I think we have to bear that point in mind. And I think we've also got to bear in mind the point that I just made to you, convener, that actually in terms of the scale and the scope of the increase here, it's actually smaller than in two of the most recent years that we have experienced in terms of the scale of the business rates increase that has taken place for companies in such a category.
Okay, and the last question I've got on business rates. There is a proposal I see to limit the rate relief on renewable energy projects to those that are wholly community owned. Do you know how much that's likely to raise?
That will raise about £10
million. Okay, thank you. I don't know if any members got any follow-up questions specifically on business rates before we move on. Patrick Harvey, yes?
Thank you, Convener. Just on that last point, have you not considered finding a way to ensure that those projects, those renewable energy projects which have an element of community ownership, gain an element of that relief which can be able to benefit the community body in question?
I would have thought that the provisions we've put in place would capture that, but I will make sure that that issue is properly and effectively captured in the approach that we take.
I wonder if we could ask for some more detail in writing about the measures or mechanisms that the Deputy First Minister is referring to. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, no one's got any follow-ups on the rates question. We'll move on, and I'll bring in Dennis Robertson on tourism.
Well, thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. there's been a slight reduction, just a slight reduction in Visit Scotland's overall budget. But do you see the tourism, obviously, is extremely important for Scotland and for economic development. we had a successful year in terms of food and drink. Do you think, in the homecoming, do you think that's sufficient in terms of our success and the platform of that success is sufficient for growth, and you're expecting another good year in terms of tourism for Scotland?
In relation to the budget, Convener, the 2015-16 budget has been inflated by about £5 million of one-off costs that were designed to build on the legacy of 2014, which, as we all appreciate, was a particularly significant year in tourism terms for Scotland. So the Visit Scotland budget in 2015-16 was essentially higher than we would have ordinarily anticipated it to be. So therefore, the setting of the budget just now, I think, is at an appropriate level to support the organisation and to assist it in its development. I think what I think is becoming ever more apparent about Visit Scotland is that it is more and more becoming an organisation that fulfils probably three purposes. One, that it gives strategic leadership to the tourism industry, but it doesn't do that exclusively. We've been greatly assisted by the work of the Scottish Tourism Alliance, which is an industry-led body which is driving a lot of the improvements in the strengthening of the tourism proposition within Scotland. Secondly, Visit Scotland is now proving itself, I think, beyond any question, to be one of the most successful marketing organisations in the world. The quality of its marketing material is extraordinary. It's assisted, I would say, by the strength of the proposition and our natural environment, but the marketing activity of Visit Scotland is, in my opinion, second to none. And thirdly, Visit Scotland is now increasingly moving towards being a digitally anchored organisation, and we see vast levels of tourism activity now being undertaken through digital means and methodologies, as opposed to how we were maybe accustomed to it, well, even 5, 10, or certainly decisively 20 years ago. So Visit Scotland is now changing as an organisation to reflect those two latter factors of being essentially predominantly a marketing organisation, and secondly, a digital, an organisation that's immersed in digital activity. And I think that therefore enables its resources to stretch much further in the work that's able to be undertaken.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. On that last point in terms of digital connectivity, obviously a lot of work has been done. In your opening statement, you mentioned the improvements within, obviously, broadband. How significant is that really for some of our smaller, more rural and remote areas to engage within tourism?
It's absolutely critical, convener, not just in terms of broadband, but also mobile connectivity. And I think I can see a route map on broadband connectivity, superfast broadband, which is really quite encouraging. I think we will certainly get to the 95% target by 2017. I'm optimistic we might even get beyond that by a combination of stretching the commitments we've already made to the superfast broadband programme, but then complementing that with the work that is undertaken by Community Broadband Scotland, or facilitated by Community Broadband Scotland, but undertaken by numerous community organisations throughout the country. I'm less optimistic as we sit here about mobile connectivity, where I'm now regularly involved in discussions with the mobile providers, but we do have significant areas of rural Scotland that really are not able to function on the type of mobile connectivity that visitors, a visitor arriving in Scotland from Japan, trying to use the connectivity with which they will be absolutely accustomed in rural Japan, will not be able to use that in large parts of Scotland. It's getting better, I accept, but we still have quite a distance to go. And what I'm trying to encourage, we have no statutory power here, but what I'm trying to encourage is a collaboration amongst the mobile operators, to which I have to say they're responding to positively, to share infrastructure and to identify ways in which we can use some of our interventions to try to support the rollout of mobile connectivity in rural Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary, you set the budget prior to the flooding incidents that have taken place in Scotland, and in areas like, for instance, in my own constituency in Ballater, to which you visited in Hogmanay. Do you see a role for Visit Scotland in helping them recover, obviously to get the infrastructure within the community, such as Ballater, or indeed places like Newton Stewart, to obviously be up and ready for the tourism coming back, say within the spring and summer?
I don't see that in terms of the recovery of the infrastructure, I don't see that as being a role for which Visit Scotland would be an organisation ideally suited to contribute.
For that,
What I've announced has so far in relation to the flooding incidents has been designed to try to partner with local authorities and businesses to get things back up and running as quickly as possible. So in some respects, if I take the Ballater example, the infrastructure support that I've made clear will be available to restore the A93 to connect Ballater with Braemar is, I think, a very important contribution to the tourism proposition. I had a meeting just on Monday in a constituency capacity with the Cairngorm National Park leadership, and they were going through with me just the scale of the damage that has been done to the walking network, the path network and the bridges network around the River Dee, and it's really very significant. And I was encouraging them to talk with Aberdeenshire Council about making sure that when Aberdeenshire Council makes a proposition to the government about access to that infrastructure resource, it is something that's sufficiently comprehensive to restore as much of the infrastructure as is possible. I think what Visit Scotland can contribute is to just affect the knowledge and the information about areas of the country that are desirable to visit. And of course Ballater, notwithstanding the floods, has had a setback earlier on in the year with the fire which took place in the former Ballater railway station, which is a magnificent piece of architecture undergoing renewal now. So there are, I think, where we have these difficulties in individual localities, I'm sure Visit Scotland can increase the accent and the emphasis on particular areas of the country and their attributes to try to encourage a return of the visitor economy.
And finally, Convener, if I may, with regard to the hospitality sector and Fair Work, do you envisage a greater uptake of the living wage within that sector? And how can you perhaps influence this to obviously encourage good and appropriate quality for our tourists coming to Scotland, and obviously to ensure that the people providing the hospitality are paid a fair wage.
In a sense, well, our approach to that is to encourage and to motivate the industry to voluntarily take part in this activity. I've visited a couple of businesses who are in the hospitality sector. They've committed themselves to the living wage, and they are seeing the fruits of that as a consequence of that commitment. They're seeing the fruits of it in terms of lower staff turnover, of greater longevity of staff staying with them, higher motivation and productivity as a consequence of people being better remunerated. So I think in the examples that I have seen, I think the tourism companies and hospitality companies that have gone down this route have seen the fruits of that. Now, I appreciate that the economics of some of these sectors make a change of that nature, an abrupt change of that nature, quite a challenge. But nonetheless, I think it's important that the work that the Fair Work Secretary takes forward in this area, in which all ministers are involved in promoting, is an important part in changing the ethos and the outlook of the sector to improve the value of the employment that is being undertaken.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Okay, thank you. A follow-up from Liz McDonald.
Thanks very much, Cabinet Deputy First Minister. You characterised Visit Scotland in your view as providing strategic leadership, marketing and digital connectivity or digital resource for the tourism sector. Given that you have made provision for a reduction in the budget of Visit Scotland this year, of I think it's 4.5% in the resource budget, where in which of those three areas do you envisage the Visit Scotland finding those savings?
Well, I think what I explained to the convener before was that the Visit Scotland budget in this current year included an additional £5 million to allow further investment. So that was essentially a follow-up to 2014, to give the organisation an opportunity to try to build on what had been an unprecedented level of attention and focus that had been in Scotland in 2014. That's not resource that ordinarily would have been there for Visit Scotland to utilise. So essentially what I think the organisation, in terms of its trend position, is broadly in a comparable position to where it would normally be in its trend financial position. But the setting out of that, of those three principal pillars of the activity of Visit Scotland is designed to give clarity about the choices that the organisation will make as to how it will spend its resources. You know, I would expect Visit Scotland to be investing heavily within marketing and digital activity, because I see that as being it's absolutely critical to how we reach people, and the capability through digital technology to reach more people than was possible under the conventional approaches that marketing campaigns would have had available to them is of an extraordinary level of comparison and capability. So I think what we can see is the resources that are available will be able to go much further, because the medium through which the resources have been used, principally digital connectivity, allow us to reach a much wider audience.
So in short, I guess what you're saying is the £5 million to build on Year of Homecoming was spent, did its job, and that essentially is a job you consider to have been done and completed.
Well, I never consider the job to be done. I think what is created is a higher platform, and then if we add to that stronger digital capability and really outstanding marketing materials, which is what I see coming out of Visit Scotland, then I think that's got that has the capability to ensure the organisation can continue to provide that very strong promotion of Scotland and the explanation of Scotland as an attractive and dynamic place to visit.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, I think we can move on to the issue of fuel poverty, and I'll start with Patrick Harvey.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Deputy First Minister. Can I begin with an apology, actually? As Mr. Swinney knows, I'm sometimes critical of the government, but I like to give credit where it's due as well. And when the budget was published, I'm afraid I have to confess I gave too much credit where it wasn't due. I congratulated the Deputy First Minister on what looked like a modest increase in the energy efficiency budget. It is an increase compared with the previous draft budget, but not with actually the amount of money that was spent in the final budget for the current year. So can I apologise for giving credit where it wasn't due? Why should we take seriously the commitment to make energy efficiency a national infrastructure priority when the budget is going down, not up?
Well, the budget is... I would describe the budget as static. That's how I would describe it. It's higher than the 2015-16 published budget document. Mr. Harvey is absolutely correct in that respect. I supplemented that during the financial year, and I've preserved those resources in the budget that's available at around about £103 million. So the in a context where the resources available to the government are reducing, then I think that's an outcome which demonstrates the government's commitment, which is not a one-off commitment. You know, over the course of the last few years, we've spent about £500 million on energy efficiency measures. So it's part of a sustained programme which I've signalled in the budget will be continued through the Scottish Energy Efficiency Programme.
Well, you describe it as a static budget. It's clearly a reduction compared with what's been spent in the current financial year. But even if we called it static, how does that square with a commitment that was made more than a year ago? November 2014, you came to the committee during its budget scrutiny that year and answered questions from my colleague Alison Johnson, and that's the point at which you said that energy efficiency would become a national infrastructure priority. 8 months later, it was confirmed as that was a formal policy announcement, and we still see nothing in the budget to demonstrate that the work that implies is going to be funded. Even looking at the infrastructure investment plan, which doesn't put much in the way of meat on the bones of this policy, it suggests that the first phase of the national infrastructure priority will be delivering existing programmes more effectively, developing new pilot schemes, and preparing for the effective implementation of powers that are set to be devolved through the Scotland Act, all of which would seem to be additional to work that's currently happening. Why is there no funding for that additional work?
Well, I think the importance is to look at all of the different elements that can come together in this respect. The first thing is to confirm that energy efficiency is a national infrastructure priority. I said that would be the case, and the government has followed that through. Secondly, in a constrained financial climate, the government has preserve the resources that are available for energy efficiency. And as I'll come on to say in a second, when we look at other areas of policy, the government is putting in resources to ensure that we are able to advance the agenda that we're pursuing here. Thirdly, we have signalled the design, the rollout of the actions to support the national infrastructure policy by the very clear commitment in the short, medium and long term to the Scottish Energy Efficiency Programme, which gives absolute continuity and certainty about the direction in which our agenda will take. And then fourthly, there are other aspects of our expenditure on non-domestic industrial energy measures, on the heat sector, which are contained in other budget lines that are not part of the energy efficiency line that we're concentrating on in this particular exchange. And we'll spend about £34 million in 16-17 on some of these measures. So I think the fact that the government is giving short, medium and long-term clarity to these areas of activities and doing that as part of a wider policy programme, I think demonstrates the commitment to implementing the national infrastructure priority.
You say that you've signalled the rollout of an ambitious new programme. I accept entirely that you've signalled it, but it doesn't look as if you've funded it. At what point would we anticipate a significant increase in funding to pay for a significant increase in activity? Would it be in 2 years' time, 3 years' time, 4 years' time?
Well, I've said to Mr. Harvey that we've given a commitment in a difficult spending round to maintain the resources in this area of expenditure on energy efficiency, but there are other contributory factors such as the ones I've just mentioned in relation to heat and low carbon infrastructure and district heating. So there's a variety of different interventions when we look at it in the round that the government is taking to advance the energy efficiency agenda in a range of different sectors. And then, you know, we've not also talked about some of the work that's going on within our public services to deliver energy efficiency schemes through the collaborations, for example, that are taking place with local authorities, the work that's been undertaken by health boards through the Green Investment Bank to try to advance some of these schemes that transform the energy use that we undertake and the cost that applies to the public sector.
There is clearly no chance that the fuel poverty target, which is for 2016, for this year, is going to be met. Isn't that ample demonstration that not just in the current financial year, but over a number of years, successive Scottish governments have not been ambitious enough on this agenda?
I don't think that's a fair characterisation, because if I look at the fuel poverty rate, if the fuel poverty rate in Scotland had if fuel prices had risen in line with inflation, then the fuel poverty rate in Scotland would be 9.5% instead of the 35% that it is, because fuel prices have increased. So I don't accept the argument that Mr. Harvey is making that there's been a lack of commitment, because he knows because he's been involved in these discussions over many years with me about a long-term commitment that we have given towards tackling fuel poverty and increasing energy efficiency. There has been sustained funding over many years. The Scottish Energy Efficiency Programme, we're giving a commitment to multi-year funding to improve energy efficiency of buildings in Scotland. And we can see that part of the challenge that we face has been about fuel prices, not about the investment that we have made in the sector.
But all agree that even since those fuel poverty targets were set in the first instance, everybody acknowledged that a devolved Scottish government can do very little about energy prices, can do less still about people's incomes, but can do a lot about energy efficiency and demand reduction. And that's where the greater effort should clearly have been if we were going to get anywhere closer to meeting that target.
But I think we've seen a situation where we've undertaken 900,000 energy efficiency measures since 2008. Now, that cannot be in anyone's book described as anything other than a substantial set of measures to support the delivery of energy efficiency.
And we must assume that there'll be fewer in the coming financial year, given the reduced budget, than in the current financial year.
Mr. Harvey and I are just going to have to part company about the size of the budget. I think the budget is, you know, by and large comparable with the budget that was under my control. There's a loss of £15 million worth of resources because the United Kingdom government has terminated one of the energy efficiency programmes that we were passing on in Scotland. Now, I can't, you know...
And consequentials are not hypothecated.
Well, but
Those particular schemes.
No, I'm sorry, that's not the case. No, that... On that particular scheme, that was a bespoke scheme that was delivered within Scotland, and which, if I'll stand to be corrected here, but I am pretty sure we were obliged to deliver it in that fashion to enable access to that resource.
But if it's withdrawn, it doesn't prevent you from using your own budgets.
Let's just separate out the two issues here and the two different considerations here. The first is that the £15 million that was part of a United Kingdom government programme, that came to an end. There was no money that came with that for 2016-17. So that's not a case of a general kind of budget choice that we've made. That is money that has stopped courtesy of the United Kingdom government. In the budgets that we have under our control, we have maintained the expenditure available for fuel poverty and energy efficiency in what has been a tough financial climate, and that comes as part of a programme that has delivered 900,000 energy efficiency measures since 2008, and to look forward, a programme which, as the Scottish Energy Efficiency Programme has set out will be a sustained multi-year financial programme to support energy efficiency within Scotland. And that, to me, is a fair characterisation of the national infrastructure priority.
Well, can I just put it to you that when you're spending millions of pounds on a consultation on fracking and other techniques that even your own party members don't want you to proceed with, and cutting the energy efficiency budget, there's got to be a question about priorities here, hasn't there?
I think the debate in Scotland needs to be served by the type of analysis that we are undertaking on unconventional energy. I think people would be quite surprised if we didn't do things properly. We frequently get criticised by some people for not looking at all of the evidence, so we have to look at the evidence because a whole variety of different opinions have got to be addressed in this process. And we are putting forward, and I think Mr. Harvey is wrong to characterise the investment the government is making as anything other than a strong, consistent level of support, which is part of a multi-year financial agreement.
Still less than you're spending this year.
Okay, thank you. I think Joe McAlpin wants to come in on the same point.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's still on the subject of fuel poverty, Cabinet Secretary. The energy company obligation, as far as I can see, Scotland seems to have leveraged out quite a substantial proportion, higher than our population share since 2013, to support, obviously, measures mitigating fuel poverty in Scotland. But I noticed that as a result of UK government changes, we lost about 93 million of eco in 2014-15. What kind of challenges does that pose in terms of our fuel poverty strategy?
Well, obviously, on Joe McAlpin's first point, she's absolutely correct that we have managed to secure 11.5% of total measures delivered under ECO in Scotland, so that the performance has been good. And what we are determined to do is to use the techniques and the methodology which has enabled us to deliver that stronger performance in the forthcoming financial years. Obviously, there's an expectation that eco funding is going to be reducing from 2017 onwards, and we will be working to make sure that the good arrangements that we have in place will be able to maximise the resources and the interventions that we can secure as a consequence of leveraging measures out of that programme for the benefit of householders in Scotland.
Does it make any difference the fact that we're being devolved powers to deliver it? I know they're quite limited, but in terms of administering and actually delivering it, does that make any difference to what we can do?
The powers have been executively devolved, which enables us to exercise some flexibility, and where we can use good techniques in the design of programmes and design of interventions, then yes. And obviously, the more we can try to combine the way in which we deliver particular services, then the better it can be to provide solutions for individuals as opposed to just delivering one bespoke programme. If we're able to design a more comprehensive offering that meets a wider set of needs of individuals, then we may manage to make the resources go a bit further. So that thinking is what underpins a lot of our approaches about the devolution of the new powers, that we'll be looking to, you know, we take that view around welfare provision as well, where we already are involved in some areas of activity already in the welfare environment. With the addition of new responsibilities, we can perhaps make a better proposition out of that range of powers. And we'll take forward the same approach on fuel poverty.
Certainly in the session on fuel poverty, where we took evidence from Stuart Wilson and Norman Kerr, they were quite critical of ECO. And I think it was Stuart Wilson described it as horrible and administratively heavy. And I assume that's perhaps something what you're talking about, that we could maybe tackle some of those problems.
These are... In all these schemes, and that's where I think we have been successful in managing to increase the proportion of measures that have been successfully obtained within Scotland, by trying to take an efficient approach about the administration and the delivery of these programmes, and if we can take them forward in an integrated way alongside other programmes and interventions that we advance, then I think there's an opportunity for us to deliver much better outcomes for individuals.
In terms of targeting the measures, I think it was both those witnesses talked about how it tended to be focused on getting the biggest bang for your buck in terms of carbon saving, which wasn't necessarily a good thing for rural Scotland, areas that I represent. I think it was Norman Kerr that said the way it tends to work is that, you know, like they'll replace a boiler in the central belt of Scotland, whereas it's more difficult in rural areas. And there was also a criticism of the Scottish index of multiple deprivation being used to target fuel poverty measures, given that fuel poverty is obviously more concentrated in rural areas, but they only represent, I think, 2% of the poverty under the Scottish index of multiple deprivation. How do you target the budget to ensure that you reach the rural households that are suffering the deepest levels of fuel poverty?
The crucial way of tackling this, I think, is by good and effective partnerships in localities to enable us to identify those who would best benefit from these measures. And the analysis that Joe McAlpin has put forward is, I understand and accept that fuel poverty will be more, it will be more easily visible in areas of urban concentration, but it is no less serious in areas of rural isolation, and indeed in some circumstances ever more challenging as a consequence. So the way that we tackle that is by effective partnerships with local authorities and other community related organisations who can provide us with the intelligence as to where measures can be most effectively deployed. I think we've got some good learning of some of the schemes that have been undertaken within the Home Energy Efficiency Programme that the government has taken forward, about how we've reached into rural localities, and by that partnership we've managed to undertake some very good planning of where the interventions could best be taken forward. But we have different working groups within government looking at how we can strengthen that proposition and how we can make it more focused to make sure that people that live in rural properties, who often will be invariably will be off gas, that they can find alternative and more sustainable forms of energy efficiency.
Thank you very much.
Okay, and I've got a follow-up on fuel poverty from Liz McDonald.
Deputy First Minister, you've acknowledged that the fuel poverty budget has been reduced from 119 million in the current year to 103.3 million in the forthcoming year, but you've said that most of that is because of £15 million of bespoke UK funding, which is no longer available. Can you tell us of the 103.3 million in the budget for the forthcoming year, how much of that is also bespoke UK funding, which you do not control and you would not necessarily replace were it to cease?
It's all our, it's all Scottish Government expenditure.
It's all Scottish Government expenditure. Mm-hmm. So the money that's been, that you say that the bespoke UK funding you're no longer able to spend is all, is that, that's 100%, all of that has ceased.
Yes.
That's the situation. Yeah. That's helpful. So clearly
on that programme, Mr. McDonald, which is the consequentials of the UK Government's Green Deal Home Improvement Fund in 2015-16, which was ended, and the consequential funding will no longer be available.
But you would accept that, taking into account the ending of that funding, your overall expenditure in this area has seen a reduction for the coming year in the order of 13%?
I know what Mr. McDonald's trying to do, but I'm simply pointing out the factual base here, that there is a programme which was bespoke UK funding which we made available for this purpose, and it has been removed, and that's the policy decision that's taken place here.
In advance of this autumn's budget process, or this year's budget process, ministers a number of times talked about embedding climate change in the budget process. Would you characterise the decisions you've taken in this area as embedding a priority in dealing with the impact of climate change or reducing, mitigating the effect of climate change?
Yes.
In what way?
In by the measures that we've taken and by providing clear and consistent support to measures to deliver energy efficiency and a variety of other measures that are part of the government's programme.
But the decision that you've taken not to find additional resource to counterbalance the loss of UK bespoke funding, as you've described, does not appear to give priority to tackling climate change.
Well, I think we've also, there's a kind of wider dimension here, Mr. McDonald, if I may say so, which is about the consequences of decisions that will be taken by the United Kingdom government. And I've been absolutely crystal clear to Parliament that it is not going to be within my gift to ameliorate all of the dreadful decisions of the United Kingdom government. And if anyone thinks that I've got the capability to ameliorate the scale of reduction, a 12.5% reduction in real terms in our budget over a 10-year period, if people think I have got the capability to ameliorate all of that, then I'm afraid that's not the case.
I don't suppose many people do assume that, but there is the question
that's
about...
Well, forgive me, Mr. McDonald, that's essentially what underpins the question that you have asked me.
Not at all. I'm not pointing you to what I want you to do. I'm asking you what priority choices you're making. And it seems to me, given that, of course, every finance minister has to make decisions, you're making a decision here that a judgment made by the UK government on a specific programme is one which you will not seek to counterbalance in any way, and therefore there is a significant reduction in the fuel poverty budget.
Well, I've got to take a range of decisions. Mr. McDonald is absolutely correct in that respect, but the £100 million of funding that we're providing in this area is £100 million more than the United Kingdom government is providing. So, you know, that's a pretty clear and tangible commitment of our determination to tackle climate change and deliver energy efficiency.
I suppose looking at the two areas I've asked you about, you described the Visit Scotland reduction as a comparable trend with where we'd expect to be, and you described the reduction in fuel poverty as static. Would it not be more direct simply to say that these are budget cuts?
No, they wouldn't, because I'm putting the budget decisions I made into a proper context, and I think the committee would expect that of me.
Okay, thank you. I think we need to move on to look at energy, and I'll bring in Richard Lapp.
Good morning, Deputy First Minister. Can I turn to the renewable and community energy budget? And can I read off, I was interested with an explanation you gave. The Scottish Government has said, the challenging macroeconomic condition for the energy sector as a whole and the raft of UK regulatory and policy changes now threaten the Scottish Government's approach to energy. I think this puts this in context, the previous question. These changes, combined with the sustained uncertainty concerning future levels of support for other technologies, such as offshore wind, have created, and I would suggest, a difficult budget and investment climate. But I note that your renewable energy line, community energy line, sees an increase of some £6 million, which, according to you, reflects the ongoing commitment to the marine energy through funding of Wave Energy Scotland. What is your view on the renewable budget and the UK renewable policies, UK government renewable policies, which have affected your budget, or this budget?
In the decisions that I've taken here, Convener, I've had to adapt to what I consider to be the market conditions that prevail within Scotland as part of the United Kingdom. And there is undoubtedly a more challenging climate in the taking forward of some of the renewable ventures as a consequence of changes in United Kingdom policy. So I'm essentially trying to utilise the resources I have most effectively to try to support our wider renewable aspirations. One of the challenges of the last few years, and I think I may have discussed this with this committee before, but I've certainly discussed it with the Finance Committee at spring and autumn budget revision time, is that we have made in the last few years some pretty significant allocations of resources to the development of renewable energy projects, but then found ourselves not able to spend that money because the projects have not come forward to attract. So not in all cases, in some cases, and there have been plenty of good projects have come forward and we have supported them, but they've not come forward in the volume that we anticipated. And I've come back at different stages over the last few years to reallocate resources where we haven't been able to spend them to make sure that they could be meeting other priorities. What I've tried to do here is to make the best assessment I can of the demand that exists for energy project support, and I've spread that across a variety of renewable and community energy projects across the capital projects on the low carbon economy and some of the wider energy requirements to ensure that we deliver a low carbon environment. These are all measures that support the wider energy policy objectives of the government, but we've attached particular significance to the development of community renewables where there is some encouraging developments that are creating sustainable projects in different parts of the country.
In regards to some of the energy renewable projects and also touching on Mary McAllan's department, do we monitor what's been done by contractors? Do we, and I'm also going on about fuel poverty, do we monitor what additional work is being done if a contractor's going to do, and it's on, and maybe I'm taking it wider a wee bit, on, you know, boiler, someone's got their boiler renewed, but someone comes in and says, oh, you also need your radiators done, but the government doesn't pay for that, but you have to pay the additional. Do we monitor what's been done? Because I have a concern that sometimes we're getting, people are being asked to do additional more work than what they should be getting done.
I think there's two different perspectives I'd take in answering that question. One is about the quality of advice that individuals should receive, and the government supports dispassionate energy advice to be available to individuals so they can make a proper and informed decision about what would be a valuable and sensible set of energy efficiency measures that they undertake. So I think it is important that people have access to that good quality advice, and the government supports the provision of that advice. Secondly, we do monitor the delivery of energy efficiency schemes, and we monitor those to make sure that there has been appropriate solutions delivered and that the interests of the public purse are being maintained as part of that process.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I think we want to move on to look at the Fair Work agenda and specifically the funding for the enterprise agencies, and I'll start with Joanne Lamont.
Thanks very much. a note from the budget that there's an identification of 1.5 million specifically in the draft budget for Fair Work. What other budget lines contribute to your commitment to Fair Work?
Well, you'll find that the work of organisations like Skills Development Scotland or Scottish Enterprise or Hands and Enterprise will be making a contribution to that Fair Work agenda into the bargain. One of the expectations that we've placed on the enterprise agencies, and particularly through the process of account management, is that we are asking the enterprise agencies to increasingly use the channel of communication they have with companies through the account management structure, which is the principal channel of communication between the agencies and companies, to use that to maximise the emphasis that's placed on companies taking the measures that are involved in the business pledge, which are not just sort of nice things to do, but beneficial things in terms of the productivity and the capability of individual companies. And they will, of course, have very significant benefits for members of the public into the bargain.
I note that the Skills Development Scotland budget has fallen by 4%.
Well, there's pressure across all of the different budgets of agencies. The resource budget of Scottish Enterprise is down by 4.6%. The resource budget of Hands and Enterprise.
But with respect, you were suggesting this was going to be a key way, along with the 1.5 million of developing the Fair Work agenda. You mentioned Skills Development Scotland. In fact, their budget has been cut by 4%.
Yes, but I've got to get organisations have got to be more productive and deliver more impact for less resources. It's a constant theme of the budget process.
So the 4% cut is because of their inefficiencies, not because you've had to simply find a way of reducing budgets. You've made an active choice to make that cut to Skills Development Scotland at the same time as you're telling me that the Fair Work agenda is one that's a clear priority for the government.
Well, I'm challenging public sector organisations to deliver more value, more impact as a consequence of the activities they undertake. And I want organisations to look at their way of operation and to work much more actively towards sharing of services and ensuring that we remove the inefficiencies that still bedevil the public sector in Scotland.
But that's a slightly different point from a point where there's an initiative round Fair Work, which I welcome. I welcome the fact there's a Cabinet Secretary without responsibility. I would be interested to know how that's mainstreamed into the thinking of government more generally rather than simply being one role. But your answer to the question, how are you developing the Fair Work agenda? So give me a general point, which is a reasonable point, about efficiency in the public sector. I'm still not clear why, if what it is you're actually investing in round Fair Work that is different. If you're applying the same rules across all the organisations?
Well, because what I explained in my answer a moment ago is that in the enterprise companies, the dialogue that Scottish Enterprise or HIE have with companies they're dealing with will be around persuading and encouraging those companies to be participants in the Fair Work agenda. Mm-hmm. That is the mainstay of the dialogue that we now undertake, mm-hmm. to encourage companies to pay the living wage, to make a commitment to the issues of gender balance within the workforce, to contribute towards improving the productivity of companies, to encourage the internationalisation of companies. These are all things that will help and strengthen the quality of employment and to advance the Fair Work agenda.
At our evidence session on the 11th of November, Scottish Enterprise confirmed, in a quote, "Our focus is on the growth element of inclusive growth. That's what Scottish Enterprise does." Do you think that's a fair reflection of the government's view of the role of Scottish Enterprise, given your statement that you're in favour of the Fair Work agenda and that Scottish Enterprise has a role in that?
It's not my view of the government's view of this, nor is it actually my view of Scottish Enterprise's view
it's
of this. John Lamont, I'm sure she's reading a quote, but you know, in my opinion, and from my dialogue with Scottish Enterprise, its board and its leadership, and in the guidance that I've given to the organisation, the issues around advancing the Fair Work agenda are part and parcel of the remit and the ethos of Scottish Enterprise.
So they were simply wrong or misrepresented when they said that their focus was on the growth element. They should have focused on both. You can't divide them in the way would that be a fair characterisation of your view, that you can't divide the inclusive bit from the growth bit? The two things have to go together, and the Fair Work agenda is at the centre of that.
That would be my view of it. I'd be grateful if John Lamont could share with me the quote that she's referring to.
Yeah, we can make sure that's we've got
well,
that.
Could I have it just
briefing.
Now?
I've quoted it to you already. The confirmed quote: "Our focus is on the growth element of inclusive growth."
I would be grateful. I can see it in the Spice briefing, but I'd like to know where that came from in Scottish Enterprise.
It came from the evidence session, 11th of November, when Scottish Enterprise
was it expressed by a representative of Scottish Enterprise?
Well, yeah, but it says Scottish Executive confirmed.
I'm not being difficult about this.
No,
because
I'm
actually
not being difficult either. But I'd be very keen. What I'm very keen on is not just, and I mean when the Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work and Skills came, it was very clear that she was committed to the job that she was to do.
Yeah.
What we would be keen to do is to make sure, or I would be keen to make sure, is that throughout government there's an understanding of equal priority to Fair Work as well as to growth, because that would then direct not just encouragement, but would direct control of public fund monies that you have within your control to give to organisations if it was informed not just by the opportunity for growth, but the opportunity to establish fair work practice.
So, I'm very happy to confirm that my view is that you cannot separate the inclusive from the growth. The inclusive growth are one and the same thing. So I'm very happy to confirm that as the government's position. What you've heard from the Fair Work Secretary is absolutely the same message that I give to the wider business community and that I give to the enterprise agencies. So I'll explore that particular quote because I don't, because I'm not comfortable with that.
Maybe just for clarity, Deputy First Minister, I think we just found it in the evidence. It was a quote. It came from Adrian Gillespie, who's the Managing Director for Operations, Company Growth, Innovation and Infrastructure at Scottish Enterprise, and it was made on the record in this committee on the 11th of November.
Right, I'll go and have a look at that because it's not certainly not wouldn't be my view of the world.
So it would be your view then informing, for example, Scottish Enterprise managing grants and so on, that they would not be given or support to organisations that didn't match some pretty basic test around fair work?
Well, I think the priority that we're attaching is to motivate companies to support the inclusive growth agenda, and that should increasingly drive the steps that we take to direct the advice that we give to companies in the work that Scottish Enterprise takes forward.
If there was no indication that people were being motivated in the way that you wanted to, would that mean that you would then be clear that they shouldn't have access to public funding?
Well, what the business pledge is a voluntary agreement. Mr. Harvey was asking me about this in Parliament last week, and we are determined to actively lead a process to encourage and to motivate the company base of Scotland to voluntarily participate
accept
in this agenda.
And I welcome that, and I think in the committee we've recognised the benefits of encouragement as well, but there is a carrot and a stick, and there's quite big carrots available to companies in accessing public funding, and I wonder whether you're willing equally to recognise that some of these organisations with very bad work practices, it would be your view that they shouldn't be accessing those grants.
But I certainly think we should use the possibilities of public sector support to drive better practice within the working place, within the workplace.
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you very much. I'm pleased that you've said that you don't recognise that view of the world in that quote from Scottish Enterprise. I think it surprised some of us as well, so I'm pleased that you're going to look into that. You've talked about using the account managed status, that relationship with companies, as a channel of communication to encourage companies to engage in this fair work agenda, hopefully sign up to the business pledge and the commitments that it embodies. And I acknowledge that it's early days. At present, we were told there are 2,300 account-managed companies and 39 or 40 have signed the business pledge. Do you think it would be reasonable if this expectation that this channel of communication is going to be successful at achieving what you want it to achieve, do you think it would be reasonable to have a target date for maybe not 100% compliance, but for compliance with the business pledge to be the norm amongst account-managed companies?
I'm not so fixated on the issue of having a target, but I certainly want to see that us making very sustained progress on this journey. So the companies, the account management process are designed to is designed to encourage the best working and business practices that can be undertaken. So we have an opportunity in that dialogue to advance many of these arguments with companies and to encourage them to participate. Now, I would be staggered if a very substantial proportion of the 2,000 or so account-managed companies were not able, or were not operating on a basis today that was absolutely consistent with the business pledge. It's just they won't have got around to signing up to the business pledge. So there'll be a lot of existing good, strong practice that's going on within those account-managed companies. There will be more that can be done, and there'll be other companies out with the account-managed system that we need to encourage and to motivate to participate, and that's what we'll continue to do.
Accept both of those points, but would it be reasonable to have a, if not a target date, a general expectation that after a year of work, we're not still looking at 2,000 account-managed companies that haven't signed up? After a couple of years, we might be getting somewhere close to halfway, for example.
I think what I'd certainly be happy to do is to look at the progress that we make and to see whether that's judged to be a reasonable amount of progress on a year-to-year basis, and if it's judged to be unreasonable, to intensify the efforts to try to improve that performance.
Perhaps an annual report to Parliament on the level
something
of uptake,
something of that type
that would be a useful suggestion.
Very helpful.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just before we leave this area of questioning, I'll just remind members we have a report, the committee's report on these issues is coming out tomorrow morning, I think, which will shed some light on these issues. And I think there is a plan to have a chamber debate on some of these questions, which we can all look forward to in the next few weeks. Sorry, Mr. Deputy First Minister, do you want to come back?
I've just actually now had put in front of me the quote that Adrian Gillespie said, and I think when I read it all, convener, I was a bit surprised when I heard it, in particular, I'm very surprised as to where it had come from. And let me read the full quote. Our focus is on the growth element of inclusive growth. That is what Scottish Enterprise does. It stimulates growth, including in the key companies and sectors that we work with. The inclusive element of that presents a big opportunity, because what we are striving for through more internationalisation and innovation is for the economy to be more productive. The more inclusive we can make our assets, whether they be people or infrastructure, and the more engaged we can make the system of people skills, the more competitive and productive the economy will be. It stands to reason, and there's evidence to show this, that more inclusive economies grow faster. So, having now seen the full quote, well, that might be your view, Mr. Harvey, but having now read
the chair, that'd be helpful.
Having now read the full quote, I understand, and I think the characterisation of it was somewhat selective.
But I think the important issue was not just about a label inclusive, but the meaning of a fair work agenda, which is actually much more focused, okay, and we'd been expecting your budget to reflect that, which I don't think it does.
But I think what I've explained today is the fact that that ethos is absorbed and taken forward by our agencies as well as by government.
Just on that point, there's a question we did look into when we did our inquiry into fair work, and it is relevant to the budget, which is, I think we're all aware that Amazon is an employer that has had some publicity for its employment practices. Let me say no more than that. Amazon were in receipt of a very substantial grant in regional selective assistance via Scottish Enterprise when they came to set up their plant in Fife. Given the way that Scottish Government policy has developed in terms of fair work, if Amazon weren't to come today seeking assistance from the Scottish Government or through its agencies, would that be forthcoming without conditions attached?
I think we would be applying the characteristics and the thinking of the business pledge to the requirements and the conditions that we would expect of a company to fulfil that was getting public assistance.
So that has moved on from the position that happened a few years ago when they did get assistance.
I think that's a fair characterisation, convener. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Chick Broad.
Thank you. Good morning. Mr. Harvey mentioned that he regrets making an apology, giving you credit for the budget. I'm not known for fawning, but having looked at the UK finances, I think you and your team deserve full credit for producing a budget, particularly that focuses on continuing the creation of wealth with London, Dublin, Brussels, and the digital connectivity. Can I just ask a question in terms of Scottish Enterprise? The capital budget has been reduced by 23%, but their business plan assumed the same capital allocation for 2016 to 2017 to 54.7 million. Now, there's been an adjustment, clearly, because of introduced a financial transaction of about 21.5 million. Can you confirm, in terms of these financial transactions which are to be repaid, do we actually believe they will be repaid? And is the mechanism there to ensure that 21.5 million that's in the Scottish Enterprise budget, there isn't one for the islands and islands, that the financial transaction budget of 21.5 million will be repaid?
Yes. When you actually look at the capital line and the financial transactions together, it totals 63.4 million compared to an SE capital budget of 54.7 in the current financial year. So there's a substantial increase in the resources available. Now, the reason why Scottish Enterprise is an appropriate organisation to utilise the financial transactions is that these are essentially loan facilities, and Scottish Enterprise is actively involved in a range of loan provision to different organisations. So there's a very good opportunity for us to use the financial transaction mechanism in an organisation that is tried and tested at issuing loans, and loans, of course, have got to be repaid.
Thank you for that. I think one of the other areas in terms of looking at, not repayment, but savings, is the strategic forum has a recovery in the budget of 40 million. How often does that forum actually meet, and do we know what they saved this year by working, by the five bodies working together?
It's not just that the forum meets. It meets a couple of times a year and under my convenorship. But it's actually the working environment that it creates that what I have been anxious to do is that there's, if we look at the responsibilities of Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, Visit Scotland, Skills Development Scotland and the Funding Council, there are some common themes in there. And what I'm anxious to do is to make sure that we create an ethos and an environment within those organisations that is purposeful about trying to achieve a much greater impact as a consequence of joint working and collaboration, rather than just each organisation working within its own domain and its own silo. So I think the strategic forum creates that opportunity and that platform, and it's able to deliver greater value as a consequence. I think I've been through with the committee before that some of the thinking that went into the formulation of the Innovation Centre proposition, which has now been taken forward and which is a significant investment by the government in improving the productivity of the economy, emerged out of our strategic forum work, and it's been a combined development proposition that's been delivered in a much more efficient and value for money context than was the case with previous ventures of this nature.
So you're content that you think the 40 million is a reasonable cross-functional saving?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Last question is, you've changed the depreciation of assets, have been changed in terms of how you moved from Scottish Enterprise, Highlands Islands into Visit Scotland, for example. How realistic are the asset registers of these organisations, do you think?
An assessment is made of the strength of assets. There can be a significant amount of variation in the strength and the value of particular assets, but these have to be done on a professional basis to provide us with, because they will drive the requirements for depreciation that will be part of our wider budget.
And sorry, just to touch on software applications and design, are these costs capitalised or are they treated as revenue? Because in some cases, people do treat them as revenue. Do they capitalise?
I would either handle as resource.
Okay. Luke McDonald.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Would you acknowledge that one of the highest priorities for the Scottish Government currently and for the foreseeable future will be to respond to the oil jobs crisis and its impact on the Scottish economy generally and the North East in particular?
Yeah, of course. The situation in the oil and gas sector is very, very challenging, and there are, as we saw yesterday with the announcement from BP and earlier the announcement about Petrofac, we've got a very significant challenge to wrestle with. We have, as Mr. McDonald will know, established the Oil and Gas Task Force, which is meeting on a regular basis and designing a work programme which is designed to be as productive and of assistance in trying to resolve what is clearly a very difficult situation.
That's helpful. And again, without wanting to encourage an exchange of quotes from the official report, Mr. Swinney may be aware I raised these questions with both enterprise agencies when they appeared as part of the pre-budget scrutiny process, and Highlands and Islands Enterprise were quick to say that they were engaged in an assessment of the economic impact of the oil jobs crisis on the Highlands and Islands. Scottish Enterprise did not make the same comment. To be fair, they did reflect some of the other priorities that they rightly have in responding to situations where people are losing their jobs. But do you accept that assessing what the impact of that crisis is on regional economies is a priority, and in order to direct funding and effort over the next year, understanding the extent of that impact will be important.
One of the points of the government's economic strategy is the increasing emphasis we place on regional economies within Scotland. So as a point of analysis, yes, I think it's important that we consider and study the strength and the capability of regional economies. The Economy Board within the Scottish Government looks at these questions and looks at how we can best take the policy measures that are designed to resolve those issues. So the Energy Jobs Task Force, for example, is just one illustration of how we take steps to try to focus on addressing what will be a more widespread issue, because there will be, I can now safely talk about this, that the GDP statistics this morning that came in at 9:30 show a decline in production, and undoubtedly that will be, that's not just a northeast of Scotland issue, that will be an issue that is emanating from the difficulties in the oil and gas sector, but will be having a much wider effect across Scotland. So it's not easy to compartmentalise all of these impacts. I accept that there will be very significant impact in the northeast of Scotland, but as the GDP statistics show, there will be a much wider effect of that across the range of regional economies within Scotland.
That's certainly a view that I and many others I know would share. A year ago, the Scottish Government, Highlands and Islands Enterprise and Scottish Enterprise all took part in and supported the Oil Jobs Summit convened by Aberdeen City Council, and that laid out some of the priorities for all public bodies in responding to the situation. The leader of Aberdeen City Council was interviewed this morning on Radio Scotland and said that, in her view, the issue now, the priority now, was for both governments, UK and Scottish governments, to come forward to the table with a positive response to the bid they have made for a city-region deal. Is that a view that Mr. Swinney would share, and is that something that can be acted upon in this financial year?
Well, there are ongoing discussions about the city deals. This is an initiative which it requires the participation and the agreement of both governments. I'm happy to confirm that there is good work undertaken in this respect. The Infrastructure Secretary met with Lord Dunlop from the United Kingdom Government on Friday to discuss these questions, and we are actively considering the different propositions that have been put to the UK Government in response to their call for bids.
And finally, is there any further provision, having looked at the budget as you have presented it, is there any further provision that would be required within the Scottish Government budget for next year in order to enable support of that bid going forward?
Well, it would depend on what the outcome of those discussions was. But obviously, if there is an outcome which requires to be supported financially, then I would have to make some decisions about that.
And that would be within the scope of what you have available to you?
I'd have to make that the case, yes.
Okay, I've got a follow-up from Dennis Robertson.
Cabinet Secretary, I'm grateful to Mr. McDonald raising the issue for especially the situation in the Aberdeen in the North East. Do you believe that there is a role for the Scottish Government in contacting the Chancellor to have meaningful tax breaks to incentivise further exploration to help stabilise the industry? And obviously, in the maybe the medium to long term, maybe aid some recovery.
I met the Chancellor. I'm just trying to think which particular conversation it was. It must have been in advance of the budget in March, and the Chancellor. We discussed the issues of oil and gas taxation and the gravity of the situation that we're facing, and the Chancellor listened to the points I made about a variety of different issues. and said he would give them consideration. And to be fair to him, he did give them consideration and acted on a substantial number of them. The one that he didn't act on was about a greater incentivisation for exploration. And in my recent letter that I wrote to the Chancellor in advance of the autumn statement, I made the case for such a relief to be considered. The Chancellor did ask me at that meeting that if he did do something which was helpful and beneficial, you know, would I support this and give it as much encouragement? And I think from the record, I think I've held my side of the bargain, that I think what was delivered by the UK government in March was helpful. I think obviously we are going through a period where the situation is becoming more challenging. So I think the need to look again at these questions it becomes ever more significant for the Chancellor and for the Scottish Government to consider.
And do you believe that such tax incentives would help maybe stabilise the industry and obviously maybe lead to, as I say, in the medium to long term, a recovery within that industry? And at the moment, is there a role for the Minister, I know through the Energy Task Force, but is there a role for the Minister to intervene at the moment with perhaps also Oil and Gas UK and the trade unions?
Well, Mr. Ewing is actively involved in persistent discussion around the oil and gas sector. It's a relentless part of his responsibilities, to which he takes very seriously. That involves discussions with companies, it involves discussions with trade unions, it involves discussions with Oil and Gas UK, it involves discussions with the Oil and Gas Authority, which I think has been a good innovation by the United Kingdom government and a well-led organisation that's in a difficult situation providing real effective leadership. So it's there are elements of what's happened which are really to be welcomed because we're in a better place. I think further incentives might help the situation. We've obviously seen an improvement in production, but obviously value is a major consideration in the current context. So I think we're in a position where we need to explore every available option to make as much of an impact as we possibly can do.
Thank you.
Thank you. I would just observe we have a short report on oil and gas coming out, I think, on Monday in consequence to the recent evidence we took on that, which will address some of these points. I think it's worth making the point in passing that in terms of the evidence we took from the sector, while I think they said that any additional tax incentives would be welcome, it wasn't at the top of their list of asks, and they were quite clear about that at this stage. If there are no more questions, I think we can draw the session to a close. Can I thank you very much, Deputy First Minister, for coming along and answering the questions, and thank you to your officials too. And at this point, we will suspend briefly and go into private session.